Hi everyone, I'm Sarah McMenemy. I'm so happy to be with you today. I run a small business in Rochester, Minnesota called Prairie Hill. And we live on 4 acres here just outside Rochester. And I produce cut flowers for bouquets, apples and pears, and honey. So in this series of videos, I'm gonna talk you through a very, very basic level of what you might need to get started with beekeeping. So maybe you've learned a little bit about bees or heard about what's going on with honeybees and you're interested in getting started. This will be a very basic. So there's a big joke in the bee world that if you ask 10 beekeepers a question, you'll get 12 answers. So you'll need to look up other resources too. But this will be at least enough to get you a basic idea of what you might need to get started. So bees are fascinating. In fact, they're one of the favorite pieces of my business. There are so many places where there's this line of mystery between what scientists and humans understand and what the bees actually do. And we don't know why or how they do certain things. So hopefully in the series, I'll be able to talk a little bit about some of those mysteries and the places that are most fascinating to me. But today, this video is really straightforward. I'm gonna talk you through the three main things that you need to get started. So you'll need a set of equipment, which includes a bee suit and honeybees. You'll need mentorship and some education, additional education beyond this, so books and resources. And then you'll need a suitable location to place your hives. So I'll talk you through each of those chunks. So first I'm gonna start by showing you some of the equipment you need to set up a hive. So the first thing you need is a stand location, and we'll talk about where that needs to be in your yard a little later. But you'll want some concrete blocks or bricks down. They make hive stands also that you can purchase, but it doesn't need to be anything too fancy, just some bricking or something hard down on the ground, preferably in a place that's level. And then you'll need a hive stand, or a bottom board. So this is the basic entrance that the bees come in. For beginners, I really recommend a screened bottom board. You can see this is just screening. It lets ventilation in. You can also put a tray in that helps you keep an eye on one of the major bee pests, which is called Varroa mite. So it helps you get an accurate count of how many mites are in your hive and possibly hurting your bees. So you start on the foundation with your hive stand. For this video though, they do make hive stands that are just wood. And so I'm gonna be using a non-screened bottom board just to show you. The next piece you need is an entrance reducer. So it's just this basic piece of wood that kind of does a couple different things. On the days, first couple of days that you put your bees in, you use this tiny entrance. Then for the next several weeks as your colony grows, you flip it this way and use the medium entrance. And then maybe a month or so later, you'll kind of have an idea when they get strong enough and the clover starts to bloom, you can take this entire entrance reducer away and they'll have the whole access. By that point, they're strong enough to defend the entire width of their entrance so that they don't get robbed out or impacted by other pests like mice. So for now, I'll put this in medium. So there's a decision point that everyone has to make about what size of equipment they use. For me, I'm about 5'5". I use all medium equipment. It's about 6 inches tall. They are also deep pieces. So the big wooden boxes are called hive bodies. I'm gonna show this a little better here. And inside the hive bodies, you'll have 10 of these plastic frames. I'll show you that again here in a second. So they make them in two sizes. A traditional hive would have 2 9-inch boxes. They're called deeps or deep hive bodies. I run all medium equipment. So I use 3 mediums instead of 2 deeps. And the reason is when these are full of bees and brood, even the mediums full of honey can weigh 35 to 45 pounds. A deep can weigh closer to 55 or 65 when it's completely full of bees and brood. It's just a heavy lift. And you will be moving these boxes, you'll be lifting them entirely up. I don't like to have to buy and maintain 2 different sizes of frames. And part of keeping your bees healthy is giving them good wax. So over time, as the bees make cocoons and have babies, your wax darkens. It also picks up pesticides and some toxins and chemicals from the environment. And you'll need to switch it out every 4 to 5 years to keep your colonies healthy and strong. So having all medium equipment gives me the opportunity to then take some of the snow pure white honeycomb from the honey boxes that the bees only really have access to for a few months of the summer when they're really putting up honey, and make it become my brood chamber wax. So it helps you rotate your wax, which keeps your colony more healthy. So I like having all medium equipment. At some point in time, you'll have a really strong colony and the boxes are going to stack way up over your head. So you're going to be lifting 45 pounds down from over your head to take it in to harvest it, which is a great situation to be in, but a very heavy lift. So just something to consider if you're a beginner. I highly recommend medium equipment. I also recommend, after you have your hive bodies, and I'll show you how they stack up here in a second, using plastic foundation or frames. These come in a big box. You get like 30 or 40 in a box. They don't come with the wax drawn. The bees have put the wax on them. So it's just a big piece of plastic. Frames are also made from wood. So I actually have both in my hives. But I prefer the plastic, particularly for beginners, just because it's a little less likely to bend. It's a lot easier to harvest when honey harvest comes because things don't break and come apart quite as easily as the wood. But it's completely a personal preference. They sell them both ways. So once you have your bottom board and your entrance reducer, you will need three, if you're running medium equipment, medium high bodies. Make sure I've got the door situated here. There. And all of these have 10 frames in each box. So I just have a few frames in these to give you an example of what they look like. So all of these have frames. You'll have 30 frames total in three boxes. This part of the hive is called the brood chamber or the brood nest. And it's where the bees make babies. So all of the eggs get laid in this box. And essentially, as the colony gets stronger, they run out of room in the lower box, you put a second box on. Then those bees start hatching out and the colony gets stronger. You'll start to see bees on all of the frames in the second box. You put a third box on with empty frames. They'll draw the wax out and fill this chamber. The third box usually has a lot of their reserve honey in it and just a little bit of brood in the top. So I think of it as almost like a big, and I'll show you this in a different video, a big ball of baby bees. It's like a big basketball in the center of these three boxes. And that's the brood chamber where they make the bees. At the peak of the season, a queen can lay 1,500 to 2,000 eggs a day. So you can imagine you start with a box of maybe 8,000 bees. At the top of the season, when you have the most flowers blooming, you should be close to 80 or 90,000 bees in the colony. Maybe even more on a good year. So, if you don't do anything from this point, they will continue to work their way up in nature. Bees move upward, laying eggs and building their colony. So what we need to do is have some way to separate where the queen is from where the honey is, right? Otherwise you're gonna have eggs in your honey and larvae and baby bees, which is really yucky. So this is the tool we use. It's called a queen excluder. It's just a metal piece of framing. And what's special about this is that the worker bees can fit through the gaps in the wires, but the queen cannot. She's too big. Her belly is too big. So all of your worker bees can come up and through, but she can't. So then that's the next piece. This keeps the queen below in the brood chamber. And the honey workers, or the workers, will move the excess honey when the season gets to the right stage up into your honey. And we call these supers, the honey supers, because honey super, right? So this is where you'll put your frames that have that beautiful white wax, and they smell amazing like honey. And so your first season, you'll do 10 frames in these boxes until they draw out the wax to this point. Your second year, it's traditional to put 9 frames in the same box. And I'll show you the tool that can help you do that and to keep the honey frames aligned. What that does is it just makes each box, they'll draw the comb wider, which is super helpful when it comes to harvest season, because you're actually going to take a hot knife and cut the sort of cappings off so that the honey can come out. So it's just helpful to have that little extra bit of wax on each of the honey frames. But for your first year as a beginner, you'll use 10 in each of the honey boxes, same as the brood nest. So let's see here. I like for there to be an upper entrance. And that can look two ways. You can either add a little bit of a shim and an entrance at the top, or a traditional way is to have a hole drilled in each of your, in one of your honey supers, at least one of them. Some people do more. And then you have a cork in it until the colony is strong enough. And then when you start putting supers on, you can take the cork out. At the end of the season, you're gonna do some special things to get all of the bees down from the honey into the brood chamber. So you'll need to be able to close this door. Otherwise, you're gonna be extracting your honey with all of the bees, and that's no fun. You'll have a way to get them, push them down into the brood nest before you start harvesting honey. So in a starter kit, they usually have 2 deeps, like I said, or 3 mediums. And then they have 2 honey supers just to get you started. Looks like this. Now, your first season, I wouldn't expect a big honey harvest. The bees are going to use a lot of nectar to just make the wax. It comes out of a certain area of their bodies, and then they manipulate it and build that honeycomb out. But it takes a ton of nectar for them to make wax. The second year, though, the wax is built, right? The beauty of this hive design. And so then your queen starts laying eggs right away, the colony builds up much faster, and you start to get a surplus of honey your second season. So 2 honey supers at least for your first colony setup. Then this is called the inner cover. It gives them an opportunity. The bees will actually come up here. They'll help fan their wings inside to draw air up to help ventilate. It's also how they dry down nectar into honey. So you'll need an inner cover. And this is called the telescoping outer cover. It just telescoping because it goes right up over the top and hangs down. One thing I didn't bring up here that is also really required, I didn't bring it with me though, is a big rock or brick to put on top. And this keeps raccoons or any pests. It keeps the wind from blowing the covers off if you have a particularly big updraft, and just overall protects the colony from predators. So that's the main colony setup. This is what I recommend for a beginner. It's called a Langstroth hive. So there was a gentleman, I think he was a minister, Reverend Lorenzo Langstroth, in 1852. They'd known about this idea of how bees build in trees, you know, in tree cavities, or when they're building a colony in nature. There's a space that's 5/16 of an inch. It's called the bee space. That's the minimum space. They won't fill it with wax, and they won't, it's not so small that they'll glue it shut. Every other space bigger, they're gonna fill with wax. Any space smaller, they're gonna glue shut with a special thing called propolis that they make and bring into the colony. And so, Reverend Langstroth figured out that he could use that concept, that 5/16 of an inch, to make a hive where you can move and lift those frames out to inspect the colony better. Otherwise, the colonies up to that point had been just like skeps, that, you know, what you, when you think of that traditional curved beehive look, but you have to tear the wax out. You can't keep it or reuse it. And so this was a huge advancement in beekeeping, and it's really, really close to the same design that he made and patented back in 1850. This is awesome for beginners. There are several other really typical or common types of hives, One is called the Top Bar Hive. You can research and look up that. There's also Worry Hive. There's a new fancy kind of hive called the Flow Hive. I don't recommend either of those to get you started, or any of them. I would start with a Langstroth hive. And then if you want to, as you get your skills and understand how the bees work in the hive, then I would say if you're interested in a different type of bee colony setup, you can try the others. But for a beginner, this is what I recommend, because it's what most people use. And so it's easiest to learn and to understand how it all works. So that's the basic colony setup. I highly suggest that if you're getting started, you get two if you can. And the reason is it just doubles your experience. It gives you one hive to compare it to. So if something strange is going on in one of your colonies, you've got a different one. There's also a couple situations where it's helpful to move frames from one colony of yours to another. And we can talk about that, what those might be later. But it is really helpful to have at least a couple to get you started. But they're a bit expensive. So if you can only afford one, that's okay too. We can talk about how you use your mentors to get more experience if you can only afford to get one hive to set up. So a couple other important tools you need. You'll need at least one metal hive tool. It's really, really simple. This helps you crack the frames, and I'll show you in a different video how to inspect hives and lift them up. Sometimes I don't use this a ton, but in the honey harvest season, you need to move bees around and get them off the frame. So this is just a really soft brush. It's called a bee brush that you'll use in harvest season particularly. And then you'll need a smoker. So in nature, when bees are exposed to smoke, it's in, you know, naturally, it's in a forest fire situation. So what they do is they think, okay, we may need to vacate our house soon. We should pack some food. So they all start eating a bunch of honey. And in that process, their bellies are full that they can't bend around to sting. It also makes them a little bit slower moving, a little bit lazy. And then another big thing that smoke does is it disrupts how bees communicate. So you're going to, and I'll show you how this happens in the next video, but you'll smoke the front entrance as you arrive, and it's kind of like knocking on the door. It actually shuts down the ability for the front guard bees who are guarding the colony to tell the rest of the hive that they're under attack or that something is coming. So it just simply disrupts the scent communication that they send. So they don't often know that you're really in there, or they can't get agitated and worked up because the communication lines are closed down. They just can't smell it when you have smoke in the colony. So anytime you're going in the hive after the first day you load your colony, which you just use sugar water for, you will use smoke. It's just, I think, a humane practice. When bees sting, they die. A piece of them comes out of their bodies, and so it's lethal. So it's actually much more humane to just use a little bit of cool smoke to disrupt them than it is to think that you can just go in and agitate and work your hives up. So safer for you and safer for them. You'll need a fire starter with a long handle. So whatever you light your grill with would work just fine. And a bee suit and gloves. So for beginners, you're gonna see videos on YouTube of people working barehanded with a veil or no veil with minimal protection. I do not suggest that as a beginner. I think fear can be a very scary thing, and there's a lot to get used to. The sound of it, the different motions that bees are making, they're super curious. For me, my hair is always a huge risk if I don't have it tied up. I'm gonna have you suit up as fully as you can, but pretend that you're not fully suited up. Like, pretend that you're barehanded and that you can get stung. And we'll talk about that when we go and inspect hives later on. So you'll need a pair of gloves. They sell these in lots of different places. And a bee suit or jacket that is white and fully covers your face and hair. I have a full body suit. This is an Ultra Breeze. It's a little bit expensive. This was probably one of my biggest investments that I made, but I've never been stung by a honeybee. The key here is how thick it is. So this is like thick layers of plastic, and that's what you're looking for. It's actually, these will still sting you if you're not careful, but your suit is so thick, or your layers are so thick, the stinger can't reach your skin. So, and you'll have to keep your suit clean every time a bee stings, and I'll just show you kind of what the whole thing looks like. So I clean mine probably 2 times a season, and then again after honey harvest, because if bees sting you, it leaves a scent. And so you can actually agitate your own bees just by the smell of your suit if you have a particularly bad hive that you've worked, or let's say a skunk or something has been bothering them and they're a little agitated and you get a few stings on your suit. It just leaves a smell there that then can agitate them the next time you come back, even if they're calm. So getting a really good suit, I think, is very, very important. Years down the road, if you want to start taking layers off and brave it, that's totally fine. But I would definitely start with a really great suit so that you feel confident and not afraid. All right, let's see. One of the last big components you need is bees. I'll talk about where to get equipment here in just a second. I tend to get my bees from Nature's Nectar, which is kind of up in the Twin Cities area. I think they do a fantastic job. There are lots of other sources though. I'm gonna talk about mentorship, and through your bee club, you may be able to find other sources where people get bees from. They come in these boxes, you order them in January, and they arrive in April usually, somewhere in that time frame, 2 or 3 pound packages. So it's kind of a box about this, you'll see it in the next video, the plastic white cage box that they come in. The two that I recommend for beginners to consider are Italian or Carniolan bees. There are lots of other types of bees on the market, different sort of fancy ones that are supposedly good at making it through the winter or fending off mites. For now, to get you started, I work almost exclusively with Carniolans. I think they're great at producing honey. They don't make crazy wax and a bunch of formations, and they don't swarm very often. So for a beginner, those are all really helpful things to consider. So Carniolans, really gentle. Italians, also a very good type of bee to purchase. A package of bees right now, I think a 3 pound package this year cost $161. So it's not a small investment. When it comes to equipment, there are, again, lots of different ways you can go. Man Lake is a great supplier that's local or in the Twin Cities area. I know a lot of people order through them. If you join a bee club or an association, you may find a lot of people who are retiring equipment. I would take the hive body pieces, the wood, if it looks clean and good. I would never take the frames inside. Maybe honey frames with the white wax if it looks really white and great. I just simply would not take anyone else's wax. You want to start with a clean slate. You don't want to be bringing any wax that might have toxins or pesticides or whatever chemicals that beekeeper may have used. You just want a clean start for your bees to give you the best experience. The full hive setup, I think they sell some of these in kits through Man Lake. It's about $550, I think, with a suit and some of the tools. But you can build your own. If you want to, that might be a more cost-effective way if you're handy enough to, you know, you want things to be really level. I don't know that I'd be handy enough to build them all as, you know, so things line up perfectly. But lots of people have that skill, and it can be really helpful. They also sell them pre-cut that you can put together, which is kind of a good way where if you're not handy with saws, you can still build your own and have a little more cost-effective of an option. So that's equipment and how the whole setup goes of this. Once you have your equipment, or you're thinking about your equipment, you're thinking about getting bees, you'll need mentorship. So I can't emphasize enough how many times I've seen folks who are asking questions in a bee club meeting, and it's almost like you wouldn't get a pet dog or cat without reading a book or understanding the breed. Really knowing what you need to take care of them. The same is so true with bees. I know they're insects, and so it seems like a completely different thing. They're not pets, but it is critical that all of us who take responsibility for beehives understand bees well and can offer the best care we can. There are a lot of factors that are impacting bees' health, and some of it's out of our hands. But it's important that beginners particularly understand what some of those things are. Sometimes it's not you or anything you've done. It's just the way the environment and the situation is that can impact your colonies. But really having a solid education is so beneficial to getting started. I think the best thing you can do is take a class in person or work with someone local who's a beekeeper. People who love bees love to talk about bees. I'm one of them. And having a great mentor is so critical, because a book's only going to get you so far. You know, even I had a mentor. You wouldn't always stand by me with the hive, but I had a mentor who would allow me to take pictures, and I would say, I'd snap a photo in my hive and say, normal or not normal? And he'd be like, normal, that's this, you know, that's a drone brood, or it looks normal to me. It's just torn open, you ripped something, you know. And that was so critical to gaining knowledge, where it's just a book can only get you so far. And then you're standing there with all these bees and you're like, holy moly. So the other thing is just making sure that if you stand by with someone, stand by them as they work their colony, you get used to the sound. You learn how to have we have like an instinct to feel afraid of that noise, which is helpful. But you kind of have to override that instinct and learn how to not be afraid, to keep yourself really calm and slow and centered and focused on what you're trying to accomplish. And so standing by someone and watching how do they move in front of, you know, behind their colonies, and what are they doing? How does it look? How does it feel to be there? I think is so critical. So I know that there's a local association somewhere near the Hudson area that of beekeepers, and I'd highly recommend joining that association. There's one down in this area, the Southeast Minnesota Beekeepers Association. The University of Minnesota has an outstanding weekend class. They also have this fantastic mentorship program where you could get a mentor through them. And I'm not sure how far they will travel, but I'm sure they could connect you with resources. So that weekend class is taught by Marla Spivak and some of the folks who work for her at the University of Minnesota Bee Lab. That's an investment I would consider making if you can. But again, you may be able to find another option even closer to you through your local bee club or bee association. But mentorship is so, so important to having a good experience and not being overwhelmed and afraid. It's just, you know, I say my neighbor worked with me last year to learn, and she got 6 hives worth of experience in 1 year versus just the one that she stood up in her yard, because she was working my hives standing by with me. So it just doubles or quadruples your experience in a single season. So that's the equipment and mentorship that you need to get started. And here in a second, I'm going to talk to you about where do you put all of this then in your yard so that you choose the right location, because it's really not fun to move a colony of bees once you place them. So we'll be back in just a second to talk about that. Okay, so if you've gotten through equipment and you've figured out your suit and your bees and your mentorship and learned a little bit more, you're going to need to find a suitable place to put your hives. So there's a couple of things to consider. You're going to want somewhere that's on higher ground, so that it's not going to get water or be sopping wet, and that you're not down in a frost pocket. So pay attention to your yard on those frosty mornings in early spring. You don't want to be in those places where the frost is. So you want to be a little bit uphill, perhaps, where cold air is going to move down and away from your colonies and not be just pulled around them. They'll be in there all winter long. People sometimes ask me, where do the bees go? They go right here all winter long, and they kind of clump in a cluster. They move really slowly around the honey frames, and they keep it at about 90 degrees all winter long in there. It's kind of an amazing thing. But you want to do everything you can to sort of keep them up a little bit higher so they're not having to sit in the coldest, wettest air. So think about that, about finding a place without a frost pocket. Traditionally, beehive front entrance doors, so the front door, the bees face south. That way they have the full range. You want them in full sun, particularly if you're in USDA growing zone, like 4 or colder, like me. If you're in north or Minnesota or Wisconsin, I would recommend facing your doors to the south if you can, so you get the full range of sun all day long, full sun. That'll get your bees, particularly on those early spring mornings of 45 degrees, so that they can go out and get out of their colonies a little bit earlier in the day. It just gives them enough warmth for the early and late season. If you are in a more urban environment and you have very close neighbors, you're going to need to consider a couple things. Your city regulations. So I happen to live right on the county side of things, so there aren't as many rules here for me. But you'll have to consider, what are the regulations where you live about how far away from dwellings beehives can be placed, how many you can have in a certain yard space. So just really understanding those things. The other biggest thing that I see people forget is understanding how bees fly. So the bee line, this is where the expression comes from. They're going to come out of the entrance down here. If you have nothing in front of them, they're going to fly at that height to wherever they're going to get either water, propolis, resin, which we'll talk about later, or nectar, and they're going to come back at that level. If you put a fence 6 feet high in front of them, you know, a couple feet in front of your colonies, or a big shrub, a bush, or something that gets them up, they're going to come up, they'll fly at that height, and then they'll come down to the flowers or water, whatever they're going to collect, and come back. So I would try to get your bees, particularly if you have neighbors, get them up. We have our fence, I think it's a 7 or 8 foot fence around my beehives, which really gets the bees way up high. So we have young children. We hardly ever have an issue. I mean, we've never had an issue with a honeybee stinging in our own yard. I have 5 colonies on 4 acres. And my neighbors have, close neighbors have colonies also. I've never been stung by a honeybee. So I think one of the keys is just really trying to get them up high as they come out of the hive. They'll fly at that height right over your heads and you won't be having bees, you know, bump into you as you're mowing or doing whatever you are doing in your yard. So considering that, give some thought, particularly if you're in the country or a rural area, to what your pest situation might look like. If you have bears, you're going to need electric fencing all the way around your apiary or your beehive area. If you have skunks, there are some strips, like carpet tag strips, that you're going to want to nail down in the front of your colony, just to keep skunks will roll. They actually eat the bees. It's very strange. They roll them and they eat them in front of the hive. And so if you put that carpet strip, they can't get their paws to get the bees. Mice are a whole other thing. Everybody has mice. We'll teach you how to keep them out in the winter. Really give some thought. I had 3 hives here at one time and 2 hives at a different location. And that was way down a hill from her driveway. It was probably a good 150 yards from my vehicle. And it was an absolute nightmare. Carrying heavy equipment, carrying the hives up and down, taking the honey supers off and carrying them all the way up to my car. It's just a lot more, having a smoker in the back of my van. So just really give some thought to how close you can get your equipment and your vehicles. If you have like a gator or, you know, some kind of mower that can carry things for you, really think about it. It's heavy stuff. You will have to move it at some point. You know, she moved after several years. I had to move those colonies. One of them had bees in it. And so it's a heavy lift. It just, I keep saying it, but it really is something to consider, that you can drive your vehicle if you're way out away from your home. Make sure that you can get a vehicle very, very close to spare yourself from having to carry things too far. You will need a storage area. If you have 2 colonies and maybe you have extra supers, so you need 2 to start, but as the season progresses, you could add as many as 4 or even 5 of these. It will be over your head in a good year. At the end of the season, these come away. They're gone. You take them off and you leave just the main 3 if this one's full enough, or you might leave 1 of these to give them extra food. So you'll need a location to store your frames. And this could be, I have a shed and I use like Tupperware or Sterilite totes to put my frames in. It could be a big, like one of those big plastic storage totes or cupboards that they make for outdoors, like to put lawn furniture or whatever your children's outside toys in. That's what my neighbor uses. A couple of keys for your storage in a northern environment. You are actually going to want it to freeze. So your frames might have wax moth, eggs or larvae inside them, and you need a hard freeze to knock that out so that it doesn't become a problem. If you were to bring them into your warm basement, you're going to have wax moths. So outdoors is the key. But they also have to be secure from mice. Mice will eat wax, they'll make nests. It's really unfun to have to deal with mice, but you will at certain points. They love to make nests under the bottom board. So if you're ever pulling an entire colony up and moving it, you're gonna encounter some mice potentially at some point. So you'll need something that's secure from mice, but cold enough to freeze, preferably. And so that everything can be closed up. You can even store things in stacks like this, as long as there's no entrance where things can get in. So if you have a flat board on the ground, you can stack your equipment right on top of that, just as long as it gets cold enough to really hard freeze the wax that you're not using on the hives. And then as you think about your location, you also, it's critical to think about, what do the bees need? So like I said, bees bring three things into the colony: water, nectar, I'm sorry, four, pollen, those kind of go together with the flowers, and a resin that they use to make a substance called propolis, which is glue. So all these little tiny cracks and crevices in between the boxes, they're gonna glue shut. It's why you need a metal tool to pop them and pry them apart. It's how they keep the wind out. They will also line certain spaces. Propolis is actually amazing. I highly encourage you to look it up and research it. It has a lot of health benefits for the colony. It protects them from bacteria and viruses. So having a colony that's bringing in a lot of propolis, it comes from the resin of certain kinds of trees. And so they'll bring it in, they'll glue all the little spaces where wax doesn't go closed. And that's good for the colony, particularly in winter. It helps protect them from wind and bacteria growing. So making sure that you're thinking about, where might the bees get their water in your area? It could be, my bees pull water most often from my bird bath, which I keep a rockin' so they don't drown. A drippy area near my water spigot. So I grow flowers, my water runs from the water spigot by my house quite often, and that's just become a location where I can almost always find my honeybees pulling water. And then I have drip line irrigation on my flower beds where I produce cut flowers, and there are just a couple places where that's the water gathering spot that they've located, and they'll come and take droplets of water back to the colony. So then consider, you don't need to put anything right next to the hives. They won't be able to find it unless it's 15 feet away. I'll talk about that later. But just consider, what might the areas of fresh, clean water be in your neighborhood or in your yard? Consider what the flowering situation is. So how much forage is there in terms of pollen and nectar, and is there enough in the early spring and enough in the late fall? Those are kind of the key windows of just flowering plants where they can get the nectar and the pollen that they need. And then the propolis just really comes from trees. I generally don't find that you have to worry too much about that. They'll find what they need. Bees will fly up to a mile, sometimes even a little bit further radius from their colony if they need to. The closer it is, the easier it is. That's the more attractive the flowers are, the closer to the hive they are. So making sure they don't have to fly miles to get things is beneficial, but don't only consider, you know, your yard area. They will go beyond that to get the things that they need. So those are kind of the four main things of keeping everything dry, making sure that their equipment stays dry in whatever area that you have it. For the most part, you're going to want easy access to your equipment. You don't want to be having to walk back and forth too many times to get the things you need when you're working your hives. So hopefully that gives you some information on where you can site your hives, where you want to place them. A couple other things that I find folks forget or don't know, or it's just not something most people talk about. If you are in a city environment, be aware that bees poop, and it sounds crazy, but as they don't use the bathroom in their own home. So as they come out of the front entrance, that's generally when they start to do a cleansing flight. So if you have a colony facing your neighbor's driveway and they park a car there, as your bees come out and fly over that person's car, it is likely that that could become an issue between you and your neighbor, where they're constantly having to wash their car if all of your cleansing flights are happening. Generally, that's the biggest issue in the early spring when the bees are first coming out of the colony. It's a lot. It's a mess. After that, it'd probably be less of a problem, but just still something to think about, where you don't want your bees to become an area of conversation with your neighbors. So a big bottle of honey goes a long way to smoothing all of that over at the end of the season. But and if you have neighbors who are gardeners, they're going to adore you because they're going to have a pollination on their tomatoes and all of their crops like they've never had before if there haven't been bees in your area. It's fantastic. So my neighbors like me for it because I help with that stuff. But it just depends on where you are and how close, you know, how well you get your bees to fly high and up and over people's heads and kids and yards. Just where you angle the doorway so that things aren't going straight into your neighbor's property initially. One other thing that's just a strange factor that comes up for people with location is swimming pools. I don't know what it is, but you're going to want to make sure that if your neighbors have a pool, you're really thoughtful about which ways your bees are going. I don't know why, but look into it. Bees seem to be attracted to the chlorine in pools, and it can just become an issue when one neighbor wants a bunch of beehives. You know, if it's one or two, it might not be an issue. But if you're having a lot of bees and someone has a nearby swimming pool, it might just be something to consider or to keep an eye on. So hopefully you can take a look around your property and find a place that's high and dry and somewhere to store your equipment and start getting things put together for yourself. So that wraps up everything that you need. Hopefully I'll be able to include some pictures of my bee yard so you have an idea of what my setup looks like. Otherwise, in the next video, I'm going to show you how do you put that package of bees into a colony. And then I'll also be showing you what does your weekly routine look like in the early spring when you're really checking on the colonies. What are you looking for? How do you open a hive and do the work of beekeeping? So, more to come. Thanks a lot.